Hi, everyone. Welcome back. Dr. Angela here with you.
Hi, Dr. Patty. God, she sounds so somber. I mean, this is cuckoo times for sure. But also, and we'll talk about this later in the video, but important to have some levity and be calm and grounded. Like, definitely. Don't sound like we're all got a death sentence here.
No, I was trying to... I was trying to channel calm energy.
Okay, that's okay.
Yeah, so we're talking about coronavirus in this video, and I know that's all any of us can probably think about these days. We're watching the news constantly. We're definitely worried about our loved ones, worried about ourselves possibly, but definitely our older loved ones, anybody who's immune compromised. And so Dr. Patty and I wanted to put together a video that's focused on what we know so far, what we do know about past viruses that are in the coronavirus family and other viruses that have had an affinity for our airways, respiratory passages, and the things that we have learned from those past viruses that have been very helpful, things we have done to prevent viral infection, things that we've done to help our bodies have a better chance of not having a really bad outcome if we do get infected, just so that we feel a little bit more empowered with things that we can do to take really good care while we're watching how things unfold together.
Mm-hmm. And so in this video, we're gonna sort of outline a little bit more about the virus itself and what we know, and then some things that we can do to empower ourselves to, as Dr. Angela was saying, you know, this is a new virus, so nobody knows, you know, anything absolutely, but we know how to strengthen our immune system. We know how to enhance our health, and we know how to correlate how we've treated viral infections in the past. And so we can make those connections, and those are ways that we can definitely empower ourselves and strengthen our immune system. But, you know, we're talking a lot about just this virus, and you know, some of you out there may not even understand what a virus is. So I just wanted to go a little bit into, just briefly, a little bit of science, mechanism of action. But unlike a bacteria that is a whole organism, a virus is really just like a fragment. And what happens is that it has to attach to a receptor on a cell so that it can then sort of commandeer and take over that cell and use its machinery to manufacture and replicate more of itself. And as Dr. Angela was saying, we do know some things. You know, the SARS virus, which was a past epidemic, was also a variant of the coronavirus. Mm-hmm. And so we have some information from knowing about SARS that it is, again, has an affinity for the lungs, and specifically the mucus-producing cells in our lungs, as well as the cilia cells in our lungs.
And the windshield wiper cells.
Yes, the tiny little hairs that like actually brush all those toxins and mucus. And mucus is interesting because it has a very clear lubricating, soothing, detoxifying, and cleansing role.
And protecting,
but too much of it can also create a problem. You know, everything in the body is about balance. And so when these mucus-producing cells are attacked by the virus, they attach to the receptors, it not only stops the lung tissue from producing the proper mucus that we need, but then whatever mucus we have in there is now stuck in the lungs. The cilia cells are also commandeered by this virus, and so now we can't get out what is stuck in there. This leads to greater inflammation and burden on the lungs, and then more of that inflammation creates an issue where the alveoli, at the bottom of the lungs where the oxygen exchange happens, it creates a thinning of that tissue, and so now there's not enough oxygen exchange and more mucus buildup, and so that's kind of what leads to the shortness of breath, which is also one of the symptoms. And so it just creates this overload, and then if that were to continue further, that is when we can go into a more serious infection, a more pneumonia-like symptom picture, possibly, you know, even a little bit more end stage.
Yeah, other respiratory complications and other organ involvement. Mm-hmm. And not everybody's going to have the same severity or involvement of symptoms, but
absolutely.
With this virus, there's a little bit more of a lower respiratory affinity, is what we know so far.
So less of the cold,
and
upper respiratory, and like draining and nose running, but and more lower respiratory. So you know, some people can have shortness of breath, dry cough, things like that.
High fever.
So keeping an eye out for those symptoms. But I also just, you know, we wanted to talk about that there's good news and bad news. So, you know, we're hearing a lot of the fear around the illness, and it is definitely something to be taken seriously, 100%. But good news is that we have seen that it can be contained, that this is something that can be managed. And as far as facts go, facts are coming in every day, information is changing. But in terms of how contagious this coronavirus is, people might want to know that. So how contagious a virus is measured by something called the R-naught value. And from what we know so far, which is difficult because we don't have a full grasp on all the numbers and all the cases because of testing and things like that, but the R-naught value seems to be around 1.5 to 3.5. And to give you a little bit of perspective, the seasonal flu is generally about less than one. A cold is about a 2. SARS was about a 3. And measles is about a 9. So if we were to kind of go in the average and say that it's like 2.5, that gives you a little bit of a clue of where the sort of contagion number is. And then also I really want to emphasize, you know, before we get into supplements and herbs and things like that, that, you know, good news and bad news. Again, good news, we know that it can be contained. We know that it can be managed. And that there is a little bit of a focus on number of confirmed cases. Mm-hmm. But also, there are people that 82% of the people who do acquire this virus may either be asymptomatic or feel really bad, but are okay. And even the media, you know, we're not highlighting those cases necessarily in terms of, I heard someone on the radio say, I want somebody who has this virus to call in and be like, okay, it's day one, this is how I feel. Okay, it's day six, this is how I feel now. And yeah, we really aren't getting that kind of information.
Yeah, I actually was just reading on, you know, my social network like feeds on Facebook. I was actually reading a case of a woman who was sharing her experience and what her process was like in her recovery, and it was actually really soothing mm-hmm. to have someone share exactly what they went through, which sounded like in her case, you know, she was clearly uncomfortable, she had a fever, she wasn't mm-hmm. feeling well, but also that, you know, not everybody is going to look like the cases we're seeing, you know, absolutely. That are being reported about where people are in the hospital. And we definitely need to be mindful. We need to follow all the advice that's given in terms of hand washing mm-hmm. and containment so that we're not spreading this virus and exposing people unnecessarily who are going to be more vulnerable to that kind of a category. But also just that there's plenty that we can do to support our immune systems. There's plenty that we know about from past viral exposures that affect lungs that can really help our lungs in this situation and really mm-hmm. minimize risks of complications. And so that's what we really want to focus on.
We can extrapolate from that information. And I think the crux of this video is finding for all of us that sweet spot of being responsible, taking this seriously, doing everything we can, and also not succumbing to fear and stress and anxiety and the worry of the unknown.
So because really, that affects our immune system
yes,
too.
Yes, absolutely. So really, and it sounds so simple and silly, like, yes, stress, you know, our fears, anxiety, but it does have a huge, huge play in terms of how our body functions. When I'm, you know, forget the coronavirus, when I'm just in a state of worry,
yeah.
even if I'm taking herbs, my body is not functioning optimally.
Our sleep is affected because we're worried mm-hmm. often. So we
yes.
really need to take very seriously anything we can do to soothe our nervous systems right now to deal with anxiety. We have other videos up on useful supplements and lifestyle practices to address mm-hmm. anxiety. It would be really good to put some of those practices in play right now if you're mm-hmm. struggling with anxiety.
And that's a great segue because yeah. we're going to first talk about lifestyle mm-hmm. changes and habits and treatments that you can do to really enhance and strengthen your immune system. And some people may say, ah, like that's too simple, like that's not gonna do anything. And we agree, we're really not saying take a deep breath and you're not gonna get coronavirus. Like that is not what we're saying at all. But it all is like a giant puzzle where
these
everything fits together.
These are all important pieces. Mm-hmm. So, you know, neglecting what we do with our daily practices also doesn't make sense.
Absolutely. And I just want to emphasize what I already said, that there have been times in my life when I have been under so much stress or so much worry or anxiety, and I see, or I'm eating a lot of sugar, and I see that it doesn't, the herbs and supplements that I'm taking are helping a little bit, but they're not able to overpower my poor lifestyle habits or my own worries and anxiety. And so just keep that in mind, that they all have to work together. So speaking of, we all know this, but this is just a really, really important reminder, is number one, sleep. Like, sleep is when we detoxify, when we rebuild our cells, when we rebuild our immune system. So really, really make sure that you are sleeping. I would, you know, the average is 7 to 9 hours, but whatever you need, I need 8 to 9, mm-hmm. and really also making sure that you are going to bed before midnight and at the same time every night, and really creating a healthy circadian rhythm. So sleep, 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 cannot emphasize that enough.
Yeah. And if you can't sleep enough at night, try to take a nap, you know, really just try to get the total hours of sleep up as much as possible.
Another thing that is a great lifestyle treatment and preventative and immune enhancer is my all-time favorite, hydrotherapy. I do have a video on how to do warming socks hydrotherapy. Mm-hmm. That's really good for boosting the immune system as well as actually treating. I talk about in the video when I had the worst flu of my life traveling in India, and all I had were those socks, and that's what I did, and it totally helped. So that, you can also do alternating hot and cold in the shower, 3 minutes hot, 30 seconds cold three times, or just ending with a blast of cold also works to strengthen.
But it's so good for us.
Yes, definitely.
Mm-hmm. So we're going to go into much more nutrition stuff, but keeping sugar low, keeping things that stress the immune system low, like alcohol.
Mm-hmm. And before we get into more detailed nutrition, a couple other lifestyle things, treatments and preventative. Sun gazing is another great one. So really, even first thing in the morning. So what that's going to do is trigger your cortisol awakening response, mm-hmm. and your adrenals being healthy and your stress response being healthy plays a huge effect on your immune system. Yeah. So not only will it do that, it would also have the double effect of getting your vitamin D up, which is a natural antiviral. So sun gazing is huge. And we've all know, because it's all we've been talking about in the media is social distancing.
Yeah.
And this is a complicated, you know, lifestyle habit that we have to implement, but definitely because we're maybe not at the level of testing that we, you know, are going to get to, or
that we're working on,
you know, right now, this is something that we are empowered to do. Like, we actually can help mitigate this, the spread and the virus, by doing social distancing practices. And so, you know, whatever you can do, if you can really self-quarantine, by all means, you know, but really working on social distancing is going to be, I think, one of the biggest tools in terms of helping flatten that curve, as they've been saying, and mitigating the spread.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And again, yes, we're adrenally fatigued a little bit, but we're not immunocompromised, Dr. Angela and I. So the most important responsibility that we have is doing all that we can to not spread this virus to those who are more susceptible, mm-hmm. right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's obvious, and we've mentioned it here before, you know, a couple minutes ago, but just keeping that stress and anxiety and worry and fear down, whatever you can do, dance in your house, breathe some fresh air, meditate, watch a funny movie, listen to a funny audiobook. I have a lot of patients who listen to very like heady health or self-help or spiritual podcasts, and I've been encouraging them even before the coronavirus to listen to audiobooks by comedians and listen to funny things. So that's going to be really helpful.
Yeah, relieve that stress and anxiety in any way you can. Mm-hmm. I mean, I have a circle of girlfriends also who are other doctors where we text each other funny memes all day just to kind of keep the lightness right now, because it feels so scary. So
definitely,
just keep laughing.
Definitely. And we do live in this age of technology. So, you know, you can FaceTime multiple friends.
Yes.
I know people who are playing games through their phones online, you know, so if you are feeling a little bit lonely or isolated with the social distancing, there are ways that you can kind of embrace that in other ways.
Yeah, I think many of our hearts melted looking at the videos coming out of Italy where people are singing to each other across the balconies, you know, just lots of ways where we can stay connected, and definitely our FaceTime and all those other technology apps we have to stay connected even if we're physically distant right now.
Yes, even though all those EMFs, not so great, but well, that's a,
always something.
That's a story for
harm reduction.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you want to talk a little bit about the nutrition?
Yeah, let's talk some more about nutrition. So we started to say, you know, keeping sugar low, that's probably the biggest thing. Keeping alcohol low. Alcohol also can cause oxidative stress in the body. So we definitely want to think about minimizing oxidative stress, because that's another thing that makes us more vulnerable to getting sick. So fried foods can really increase oxidative stress. Poor quality fats like trans fats, or really cheap vegetable oils like canola oil, not favorable at all. We really want to focus on nutrient-dense foods, so lots of vegetables, fruits that are high in antioxidants, so berries are always ideal. Anything that's got a lot of pigments, those purples, like radicchio, purple cabbage, those are all going to be really great foods that help bring up the antioxidant level in the body. Mushrooms.
But if your grocery stores are like the yes. ones near me, whatever you can get, you know, yeah. radicchio, I mean, that's real fancy. Like, you might want to just try to get some frozen broccoli,
yeah,
if you
frozen
can.
Frozen veggies, you know, are actually great. Really keep a lot of the nutritional content. We can use canned foods for more of the, like, sardines or tuna, things like
legumes.
That. Yep, and dried beans and things like that.
Yeah.
But the frozen is really great for
if
veggies.
If you can get your hands on it. But I will say this, if you're still going to your local grocery store, because everyone has sort of been panic buying in terms of all the non-perishable vegetables and frozen vegetables and canned foods, like, there's tons of fresh vegetables. So feel free to pick those up if you are still, you know, going to the grocery stores. And depending on when you're watching this, I mean, everything is changing day by day. So our, you know, quarantine, social distancing may be changing by the time you watch this. But if you are still going to the grocery store and it's stocked, if it's anything like mine, there's tons of fresh greens and vegetables. And I bought a bunch of carrots and greens, and, you know, so I'll be cooking those up until those go bad and we can't go to the grocery store.
Definitely, we could even freeze some of those in preparation if we know how to do that, and we can do a combination.
If we know how to do that.
Some of those are city dwellers. So
as the girl who does not like to cook, she's like, if you know how to cook and freeze
something,
do that.
I was a kid who, like, showed up at the table when the meal was ready, so I know, I'm learning still.
So soups, you know.
It's come a long way.
But yeah, I'm not a huge, I cook more than her, but I'm not a huge chef either, and I know some people are doing, like, lasagnas and things. You know, I'm gluten-free. We're both gluten-free, so that's not really an option unless you can get gluten-free pastas. But there's definitely soups and casseroles and things that you can sort of make. I mean, casseroles, am I from the 1950s? I don't know why I just said that. But you know what I mean. So lots of things that you can actually cook and eat. Don't panic.
Yeah, but along these lines too, just really thinking in the direction of nutrient dense, right? So, you know, processed food, having things that are just, you know, lots of flour, never great for our immune system anyway.
Yeah.
So yeah, it'll keep us alive if we need
yes.
to have those foods, but really trying to be thoughtful when we're thinking about short-term food and long-term food, picking foods that are more nutrient dense, and so we can put little examples.
Yeah, I met a wonderful family at the grocery store the other
story
day.
Story made me laugh. Go on.
And I loved the mom. She's a nurse in a nursing home, so doing great work. She was there with her two gorgeous teenage daughters. The one teenage daughter was like whining and begging her to buy something, and we got to talking, and then we parted ways, and she was checking out at the next cashier next to me, and I looked over and she was getting 12 bottles of wine and I think maybe like two things of food, and I even jokingly said, like, aren't you gonna buy some food for your kids? And she just sort of like laughed it off. I mean, maybe they had already done their shopping, I don't know, but a lot of people are taking this opportunity of social distancing to eat a lot of chips and crackers and drinking a lot of alcohol and sugar. This is not a time to hoard and eat junk food.
No, easy does it and careful.
Yeah, I mean, a little, once, you know, a little bit is fine, but if you do too much of it, it's going to drastically depress your immune system, and that is not what we want right now. So
no, definitely not.
Definitely be mindful of not overdoing it in that junk food department. And it is hard when you're buying non-perishables not to just lean towards the sugars and the crackers and the processed carbs and refined carbs and all of that. So that pretty much sums it up for nutrition. But if you have any other questions regarding nutrition and the immune system, definitely leave it down below. This video is already getting long, but we're going to talk about our favorite supplements and herbs. So do you want to?
Yeah, before we start in there, I'm just going to say too, you know, I've been reading a lot of studies, and so has Dr. Patty, just as things are evolving, and then looking into past studies about other respiratory infections. And so one of the things that keeps coming up is how protective keeping our antioxidants up is in terms of our lung tissue and also not getting sick, and if we do get sick, recovering faster. And so in the past, we had done a video on NAC, which we'll link here, but in terms of the supplements, keeping antioxidants high, keeping the immune system strengthened, and then doing antivirals has definitely been the direction that I have chosen in terms of preventive approach. And so one thing about the lifestyle thing, and then we'll go into supplements, is that, and we really want to be mindful about smoking too, because smoking really increases oxidative stress in the lungs, and this is a virus that, you know, really has an affinity for our lungs. So I know sometimes it's not possible to quit smoking overnight, but, you know, just to be mindful in that direction. If you do smoke, perhaps take extra antioxidants, and you know, for people who have choices, maybe they'll social smoke with like marijuana, maybe use edibles instead of smoking, because oxidative stress is really an issue for the lungs.
Yes, absolutely.
So in terms of supplements, what I have chosen to take proactively, have my family on when my patients are asking me, the top ones that I have chosen are NAC, vitamin C, vitamin D.
And liposomal vitamin C, if you
can. Definitely. It sticks around longer. So vitamin C is normally water soluble. And when we take liposomal, it becomes fat soluble as well. So it just, we have more round the clock covered, so you don't have to dose as often throughout the day. Vitamin A is very helpful. It's antiviral. The one caveat is if you have any issues with like liver disease, we've got to be careful with vitamin A. If you are actively trying to get pregnant, you need to be careful with vitamin A.
But not long term.
This is definitely a short term, like 1 to 3 month kind of thing, just while we're getting through this virus situation. That's essentially what's in, you know, my daily routine. I do take some selenium as well. I had elderberry in my daily protocol just because it's, you know, so antiviral and so high in antioxidants. It's interesting. There is a little bit of mention out there for some individuals who maybe have a propensity towards autoimmune issues that elderberry could trigger, you know, a little bit of a flare up, so to speak. Like if you had something like rheumatoid arthritis or something like that. I am very prone, my body's very sensitive, and I can get inflamed at different times, and I wasn't feeling well on elderberry, so I pulled it from my daily routine. But you know, everything we do should help us feel only good. So elderberry is very safe and very helpful for most people, but just, you know, there are people on some social media posts that have noticed that maybe for them, they're a little bit triggered by elderberry if you're prone to autoimmune issues or inflammation issues.
Or that it might sort of, it works to help kind of boost the immune system. Yep. And so for some people, there can be sort of an immune hyperreactivity.
Definitely.
And so there might be an exacerbation of symptoms. Yeah. So everything that we're saying in this video, these are general guidelines, obviously work with your own integrative or naturopathic doctor or functional medicine doctor, and kind of go from there. So I agree with all of Dr. Angela's top five, I think those were. NAC, I'm definitely a huge fan of. I've been taking it in general for my own health issues. So that's something that I've already been implementing. I also like to incorporate some herbs. I have some favorite herbs. And if you're a patient of mine who's watching this, you've heard me recommend this a million times, but I love Oregon grape. It's in that berberine, golden seal, hydrastis family, very bitter, but it's like an herbal antimicrobial. It's good preventative, and it's, you know, sometimes if you don't have anything at home, it's a good single herb that you can pick up. Going back to that India story that I mentioned earlier, I had the wool socks and one bottle of Oregon grape, and that's literally all I took with
me.
That
was the medicine of
the
trip.
That was the medicine, yes. And it was recommended to me by my herbal my botanicals teacher when I was in school. Another herb that I really enjoy, and this is even pre-coronavirus, is Melissa or lemon balm, because it is antiviral.
Great antiviral.
And good for modulating mood. Mm-hmm. So really helpful for anxiety and depression.
I forget about that. It's true.
And it's just a very loving, nourishing herb. I wouldn't call it the strongest antiviral. So once you are actually having symptoms or sick, maybe not only doing that one. That wouldn't be a single herb that I would choose, but great to put in the mix, and just so helpful for stress as well. And so that's got like double duty. And then I really love the medicinal beneficial mushrooms. So a blend that I enjoy is My Community by Host Defense, and that has all 12 really good mushrooms, cordyceps, reishi, lion's mane, like turkey tail, all that in there. So that's a formula that I really enjoy.
They're a great company. I love all their products.
Yeah, and what's great is you know, you can get it through our dispensary, you can find it in health food stores, and they're physician grade quality. So that's one that I really love. And then adaptogens, you know, we're talking about the actual lungs and antivirals, but let's go a little bit deeper and actually like spread, kind of look at the bigger picture, and we got to keep our overall reserves high.
That's exactly the word in my mind, the reserves. Yeah,
I know, we're really... So the adaptogens, and I have a few videos on adaptogens,
which you can
watch later, but the adaptogens help strengthen our adrenals, strengthen our body's response to stress, keep those reserves high so that we're not draining our gas tank. If our gas tank is drained, then we're going to be more susceptible to everything.
And really, it's harder to get over things. So we get sick more often. It takes us forever to get over things. We get sick again.
Definitely. So those would be my additions. And these are kind of what we are recommending as our top favorites for preventative, you know, just for any upper respiratory infection, for
any
viral
stuff, even for flu. Just these are
definitely
good things to keep our bodies strong.
And we wanted to kind of hone in because there's a million herbs and supplements out there that are really helpful. It does not mean that you have to take all of them. This is just what we've narrowed it down to that are sort of our top favorites right now. And what I really like about the three that I chose, so not only are they preventative, but the Melissa, Oregon grape, and the mushrooms, you can just, if you were to start getting symptoms, you can then just take the same things and just up the dose. So that would be really simple. But in addition to these sort of like top pared down selections, there are additional heavy hitters, if you will, of like what you would take to actually treat or work on if you have an infection.
Yeah, so in my medicine cabinet, so definitely we can, again, just dose up on some of the things we were taking for prevention, so I'll talk about some of that in the description box, but then adding in some other things, like when I'm going down, I always have like extra licorice in the medicine cabinet, great antiviral herb, also really helps the adrenals. I tend to throw in colloidal silver multiple times a day. When I'm taking things like vitamin C, I'll take some colloidal silver.
See, I'm not a silver fan. Mm-hmm. I do think that it works. And, you know, even though we do these videos together, we do practice differently.
Yeah.
So every doctor is going to be a little bit different. So I've never had a real draw to the silver, but it is definitely antimicrobial, antiviral, good for the immune system. It's not what I reach for, but add that to the list.
Yeah, and we can have lots of things in our medicine cabinets that we reach for different things, and there's lots of roads to healing. So there's lots of things that will work for each of us, and so it's really about figuring out what works best for you.
Yeah.
When your immune defenses are down, when you get sick over time, these are things that have worked really well for me in my practice, and Dr. Patty has another, you know, 13 plus years of experience where she's learned a lot of things, you know. So oregano oil is always in my medicine cabinet.
Very warming. So from a Chinese medicine perspective, if you're already like a very hot constitution, that may not be the best thing, but excellent, excellent antiviral.
Yep.
I love oil of oregano. I take it quite often. I mentioned Oregon grape earlier, and in that same family is golden seal. Again, doesn't taste so great, but an excellent, excellent overall antimicrobial. And then cat's claw is another very helpful antiviral. These are sort of just more of the herbs. And then I always remember, because my dog's name is Olive, but olive leaf. And that's one that a lot of people have heard of. Olive leaf is a great antiviral as well.
Yeah. And then also, you know, oftentimes a lot of us, if we, you know, are getting sick and lungs are involved, some coughs start up. So having different types of formulas around that really helps soothe the lungs, calm down cough. I really love the company Wish Garden. I use their Serious Cough formula a lot. There's quite a few wonderful products on the market. I use combos a lot just so I don't have to mix so many different things. There's OSHA and different nice
Molin. Yeah, and we're gonna, just because this video is already getting so long, either as a video together, or maybe one of us might just do it as a solo, we will post another video of herbs that are, have a particular affinity for the lungs.
To go more
so
into that.
If you're interested in that, let us know. Leave a comment in the comments below. And if that's something that would interest you, we'll do a separate video on just lung-soothing herbs. But a couple other like combo formulas that I like for the respiratory system. Mm-hmm. One is Respiratory Easy. Again, if you're a patient of mine, this is one I've recommended in the past. It's very good for everything from shortness of breath to coughing. Really opens up the lungs. And then Wise Woman is another company that I really, really love. Very good quality. And they have a cough formula that's also really good for the lungs called CE1 or CE2 Elixir. And we'll put these all in the description box below. So in addition to sort of the single nutrients that we talked about, from like NAC to Oregon grape to cat's claw, these are sort of lung formulas that are combos.
I know we covered lots of stuff and talked about a lot. We'll add much more to the description box too, just because I know it was a lot to think about all at once and just help organize it. If you guys have more questions, as we're all learning together, please add comments. Yeah. We'll update things too as we learn things and things.
I mean, we could have made like a 2-hour long video because there's just so much information. So if there's anything that you have questions about or would like for us to discuss, especially in relation to everything that's going on right now with the coronavirus or immune health, please, please do not hesitate to leave a question down below and we'll do the best that we can. We're not infectious disease specialists. We're not immunologists. We know what we know. We have been working for decades helping patients with, you know, viral infections, upper respiratory infections, keeping our immune system strong, keeping our bodies healthy. And so that's what we're experts at. Yeah. And we can actually use that information to apply it here and help all of you and help our families and us as well. So let's keep the dialogue going, because also that's going to help to dissipate fear as well if we're talking and discussing and helping each other.
Yeah, sharing our concerns, sharing our fears, asking questions, learning together. So everyone, continue to take really wonderful care of yourself. Help anyone you know. Share information that, you know, can help a friend. Let us know what you want to keep learning about as this unfolds, and we'll do our best to keep addressing those questions, that content. We love you all. Stay very healthy and safe, and we'll see you back here soon.
Take care.
Take care.